Okay, at 6:30 on May 2nd, we'll call the Conway Board of Selectmen to order. First item on the agenda is the minutes for the April 19th meeting. Has everybody reviewed the minutes? Any changes or additions?
There was one slip where the adjournment was seconded by Jim, and we did change that to Bob Baker in the final minutes that you have.
Oh, good. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So, but these
are good.
Fine.
Yeah. These are really
okay.
Good.
So I'll make a motion that we approve the minutes for the April 19th meeting. Second. Do we have a second? All right. Thank you. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
You can't vote there.
That's right. You can't vote.
So, abstention?
Abstention. Second item on our agenda is the warrants. The vendor warrant, $37,641, a payroll warrant of $86,689, and a payroll deduction warrant of $22,947. I'll make a motion that we approve those warrants. Do I have a second?
Second motion.
Yeah. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, next item on the agenda is meetings attended by select board members. Any meetings attended since the last meeting?
I went to a DOT meeting about the money that they have and what they're going to do with it and such. It wasn't exactly what I expected for the meeting, so I didn't know that it really applied, but my concern had been something I asked at a Stan Rosenberg meeting about 3 or 4 years ago in Northampton to a DOT person. I went to that little workshop. Why can't the state have 5 or 6 or 7 modifiable plans for highway garages? Because it's ridiculous that our towns have to spend over $150,000 for that. And then it expires after 3 years, and you got to start all over. And then on top of that, all of the hoops you have to jump through to get the permitting, besides that cost. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a ridiculous way of doing business. And he said, well, if you'd asked me that question, I'd have said, no, the state can't do that. This guy. But the guy at the meeting a few years ago said, sure, we could do that. Mm-hmm. And that was the last I ever heard. No, it's never come up as far as I know. And I just wanted to mention it again. And basically, it was one of those political things, like the select board meeting we went to where the guy got up and talked but didn't really say anything. Mm-hmm. Where he said, well, we've got this much money and this is what we're going to do with it. And bye-bye.
Yeah. No, I think that's an excellent suggestion. It certainly should be considered. You know,
it's up to the legislature to make the rules. DOT has to follow the rules in existence.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. So we've got to put a bug in the ear of the legislature.
I went last Tuesday night to the monthly Frank County Fire Chiefs Association meeting. The only reason I'm going to bring this up is one of the articles we discussed was how the small fairs and events and festivals can survive with French fry booths and stuff. And the fire marshals, I was there, and said that it would be, they've made changes, made many modified recommendations.
Oh, good.
And that would be coming out in the next 10 days, and I just received it today. It's just a 10 little point thing that should be absolutely no hurdle for them not have problems getting over it.
Okay.
So
we're serving
franchise.
Food at our
right, exactly.
Meetings.
And I think that's a great thing. So.
Yeah.
Good. It worked out for the Greenville Chief and then pushed for that, and it worked out wonderful. So I think it's a
good.
I'll
thanks,
be getting
Bob.
That to our festival committee.
Good.
Yeah. Good. Thanks.
It wasn't a meeting, but we all attended the Frontier Youth Cal Ripken League opening ceremonies that were held in Conway on Saturday, and it was a wonderful event. We had a tremendous number of kids there and parents. And
I was surprised at how many kids there were there.
It was great.
Absolutely wonderful.
Great event. And I'm glad that we held it here, and boy, I can't wait to do it again down the road.
John made a formal thank you to our Parks and Rec Committee, present and past, and the people that got the grant lined up and stuff for the wonderful work they did on the ball field. It's, I think it's fabulous.
Yes, yes. Good facility.
Very, yeah. Very nice.
Okay. What I want to do is move our poll hearing up on the agenda to the next item. So,
okay.
Come on up. And your name is?
Paul Lebowski.
Paul. Okay. What do we have?
On East Guinea Road, petitioning to install 9 mid-span poles. Basically, as a reliability standpoint on our end, we want to eliminate the existing 3-phase that goes down the street, run new covered tree cover wiring, single phase down the street, and by installing those 9 poles down the street, we're looking to lessen the span of the existing spans that are there.
Okay, so I do want to mention that all of the abutters were notified properly, and we have not heard back from any of them. So I would make the assumption then that none of them are opposed to this, to this move.
And in addition, the Conservation Commission has no problem with it, and the Highway Department has no problem with it.
Good.
And essentially, this will increase the reliability.
Correct.
Along this span?
Down the whole entire street. They are only doing up to, it was 9 poles due to budgeting, mm-hmm. but they look to, Eversource looks to do next year, probably continue down the street.
Wonderful.
Okay. But the whole idea of this is to improve reliability.
Yes.
Correct? Okay. Any questions for Paul?
Can't think of anything. If the abutters
don't complain,
aren't saying anything, then I guess we don't have anything to deal with there.
All right. I'll make a motion that we approve this plan that Paul has presented tonight to improve the reliability by installing new single-phase primary covered cable and installing new poles to short the existing span lengths. And this is the drawing that represents that that plan. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Paul, thank you very much.
Thank you, Paul.
Thank you, Paul. Yeah.
Appreciate you coming out tonight.
Coming in.
Next item on our agenda, town meeting items. Tom?
Yeah. I have three general categories, motions, pipeline articles, and other. Under other, I just have a couple of notes, and if I can get those out of the way, that would be good. We did finally get a final figure for tuition from Smith Volk. Mm-hmm. It's lower than my estimate.
This is good.
So we can lower the amount under technical schools by $2,868, and therefore also lower the final rise.
$2,868.
Very good. And, Tom, excuse me a second, Tom. For the poll hearing, we need to sign this.
Oh, there is a signature. I think it's just one that's required on it.
Looks like.
Unless it's three. Oh, it's all three?
All three.
Okay, sorry.
All right.
Yeah.
Go ahead. We'll just sign these as you're speaking.
Yeah. So if we want to do an amended motion for Article 2, that will be fine. And also for Article 12, the figure for the operating expenses for the ambulance department coming from their receipts reserve should be raised by $245 to $22,217, and I have both of those noted in these minutes. So I just wanted to mention that, and then the planning board will also have a handout about one of their articles. The way it got printed in the warrant did not include striking out all of the provisions that they were striking out. It only includes the way it would look with the new language. Okay. So they're going to hand out that to show what's being struck.
Just two.
Yeah. And so these then are the draft motions.
Can we legally, is it legal to raise this once, not, this is a simple question, is it legal to raise any amount after it's been printed and sent out?
It's at the moderator's discretion.
Okay, because years ago, they always just say you can't raise it one dime. You can lower it, but you never could raise it.
Well,
that's, that was years past.
Yes, it's whether it's within the scope of the article. In it has been interpreted to be even within 10%, but I figure $245 should be reasonable. I think our moderator would find that a reasonable.
I've been to a number of town meetings lately where it has been raised.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And so some of them were pretty substantial. No, it was like, whoa.
Again, 10% is the figure that gets thrown out.
That's quite a bit of money, 10%.
Yes, it is.
$500,000.
All right, so these are the suggested motions. All right.
And I've, you can see how I've reworded Articles 2 and 11 based on... I'm sorry, 12, 2 and 12. Mm-hmm. Now that, yes.
Right, okay. Yeah, I don't see a big problem with that.
So the main thing is...
Do you want to move? Article 1, you want to move? No.
Well, we usually...
Or you can move to table.
We usually waive that.
Okay.
The moderator usually does that. He waives the reading of the reports because everybody's received a town report.
Sure. It would probably be useful to say that there is a special report from the Wastewater Committee later in the agenda, just to let people know. This is, technically, this is to hear the reports that are printed in the annual report. So it's the reports about fiscal year 15, the previous fiscal year. So that's really what this is referring to, and the Wastewater Committee has more of a current update, so that it's separate from this, really.
Okay.
And everyone has the reports from last year in the town report.
All right, great. These look good, Tom. Now the pipeline article.
Does Article 3 change different, though? No?
And then I'll have...
That's not different.
No,
yet.
No. I will also have talking points for each of these, just to remind you of the major reasons for each of them.
Right, okay. And the pipeline articles?
That one...
Which one's the Montague article?
That's 21. So, yes, 20 will probably be changed. This is, again, the draft just as of today. 20 will probably be changed to move to table.
Yeah.
Meg, can you, this is, yes, we're going over the pipeline rooms now. Which is right.
Come on up, Meg.
That's why I'm here. Not my office. Yeah.
You mean you just didn't come to watch?
Oh, wonderful people.
So what's happening with the pipeline?
Usually John reads the motions, but I know these are coming from the committee. I don't know how you want to manage that.
Controversial ones, I'll let
you make. Yeah,
I'll throw arrows at you.
Target practice.
Mm-hmm. Would you be willing to make the motions for Article 20 and 21 there?
Yes.
You don't have to make the motion. You can explain it.
The Board of Health last Monday voted to keep the warrant article on the testing.
Oh, okay.
Okay, all right.
The rationale being that since the project is suspended...
And not... Totally.
And not canceled, and Kinder Morgan is sort of reassessing where they're at.
Mm-hmm. They're definitely going to come back.
Yeah. The feeling was if we totally drop this and it comes back this summer,
right,
we're going to be scrambling.
Right.
And we'll be scrambling to do anything before.
Right. Good idea.
The concern was we would be scrambling To get any air quality testing or to get some of the additional water testing done. Mm-hmm. And I apologize, Tom. I meant to get back to you last week. That was my oversight.
Well, we have time. I apologize. We have time. Not a problem.
It was a busy week last week.
Okay.
We just leave it the way it is, or just let the townspeople decide it, right?
Exactly.
Yeah. Marie Eichen has been working on some of the details in terms of the water testing and what exactly would be covered there. Mm-hmm. The bylaw that was passed at special town meeting covers up to 1,000 feet.
Mm-hmm.
And she was looking at sort of what are the households up to a half mile from. So from 1,000 feet, the additional distance.
Half mile, huh?
To a half mile.
It's a long way.
It is a long way.
Sometimes there have been effects 6 miles away.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or things that have happened.
Yeah.
Okay. All depends on your aquifer.
Yeah.
It all depends on the aquifer.
Yeah.
That's right.
Probably in Conway, it's not going to be too many more households because we're so sparse an area out there.
53.
That's why they don't want to run. They want to run it through here. 53. Oh, it doesn't matter if it blows up here because there are not many houses.
53 households in that span
in a half
between
mile?
1,000 feet and a half mile of the route. Which was more than
I thought. Yeah,
it's more than I would have thought.
Me too.
Yeah, me too. How many in that first 1,000? Do we know?
I can find out from Maria.
Probably not a bad idea to compare.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then the is it in Article 21?
21 is Montague.
The request is that we continue with this article as well.
And I had added at Joe's direction, and I think we were all in contact at one point, a phrase at the end, contingent on the continuance of the application of Berkshire Gas for natural gas from the Northeast Direct Pipeline.
So that tells me, in other words, is right at this point, you won't send them the $5,000. You hold on until they actually file the application.
Yes, and everyone's waiting until May 26th, which is the Kinder Morgan's date that they promised FERC they would have a decision by. It's a soft deadline. It's Kinder Morgan's more or less internal deadline that they've given to Kinder, that they've given to FERC. But I'll just also note that none of this, of course, requires the town to spend the money. It merely authorizes the town to spend the money.
Right. Fine. Okay.
I'll try and check on that additional wording.
That came from Joe, you said?
Yeah, via Montague.
Oh, okay.
I mean, it came via Joe from Montague.
Okay, so that was that additional wording on the article was from Montague?
Yeah, but check on it anyway.
Okay. Okay.
Check
I just
on everything.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I know Deerfield and Leverett have both passed.
They have.
Their motions, yeah.
Okay.
Well, if they had a contingent upon that, too, on theirs.
I have to check that.
I don't think they did. I think the understanding was, as at the last MCAP meeting that was discussed, if they do not have to proceed with this, then whatever money they don't have to spend will be returned to the towns.
Because wasn't there an article in the paper a week or so ago or 2 weeks ago that said that they've already overspent their budget on lawyers' fees and they would help some of these other towns help defray their cost? Wasn't that
that
way?
Yes, they spent the money they had set aside, which I think was about $20,000. And they've spent some of the money that has been given to them by some of the other towns. And
they almost made it sound like they had unpaid bills still. Maybe
they may
have. Money
I don't know if the lawyer has sent all the bills to them or not.
I don't know.
Well, you know lawyers. Like send bills. Send bills.
Okay. Great. Anything else, Mac?
Nope.
Great.
Well, sort of
thank you for coming.
Folding pattern, right?
Yeah.
Folding pattern.
Yeah, right now.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you, Meg.
Yep.
Anything else on the motions, Tom?
No, I have been talking with Kate Whitcomb about the Festival of the Hills Committee, just sort of refining their talking points and getting her in touch with Joyce, and they had a conversation today, so
okay.
That's all moving ahead.
Because I think that will be a controversial article, from what I've heard so far.
Yeah, I've heard some.
Well, I think people may not understand that the initiative is actually coming from the committee, so...
Yeah.
One of the comments I've heard is townspeople really are shocked that they want to pull away from the town because that makes other requirements of them that they may have to start paying for other things that now are getting for free. And that was their concern. That mm-hmm. may,
such as insurance.
Such as maybe police department.
Well, sure.
And fire and emergency mm-hmm. services, if they're not a division of the town. A
lot of costs. Yeah,
mm-hmm. yeah, you gotta think about though. Them things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, anything else on the motions?
I don't have anything else. Okay.
How about Open Space Committee?
You remember, they were in earlier with their proposal for a botanical inventory of the Rose property, that has been... The cost of that has gone up, and I just wanted to let you know, more or less, it's risen to $400 due to the insurance requirements, and so it's now $3,100. They do have plenty of money for it. I just wanted to make it...
all part of that grant.
Yeah, I just wanted to make it a public statement.
In discussions on that, I met with Jack Lockett two or 3 weeks ago. He came to me, and we discussed... possibly having that whole field real remote, because it's all nothing but dead standing, you can see it, dead standing weeds mm-hmm. right now. Now, whether that would affect their botanical work they want to do there or not, we need to find that out. And if we could, I would like to ask the highway superintendent if he could at all possibly have equipment to get that mowed with. Sure. Because right now it's a big fire danger.
Okay. Well, it is. Yeah. We on a good day, the only good day we found, we burned some brush.
You were real careful about
it. And we were extremely careful to make sure it didn't go. But
that whole field
everything
was
behind us was dry.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
And also to go along with that, I have met with the fire marshal and Malcolm Kors, who's his job on the tournament, the celebration next year is to look into fireworks, and we've met with two different fireworks companies, and that's the area where the only area in town that we can shoot fireworks off in. And they all said...
Is that in the Rose Field?
In the middle of that Rose Field. It all has to be barricaded off and everything else to make it all safe, and it's got enough distance from houses and stuff like that. And they all said, hope this is all mowed, not like left like this.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, of course, we've been waiting for the work to get started in the mm-hmm. floodplain lowering and all of that.
But that wouldn't affect the work, doing that.
Well, it's going to be an acre of the territory.
But it wouldn't, just mowing the top surface out wouldn't affect that working at all.
Why wouldn't we do the fireworks in the community pool field?
Too close to homes.
Yeah.
Right.
You have to have a minimum of 285 feet from any home.
Okay. And well, that wouldn't make
over,
it. Okay.
Over 200 feet from a roadway. So you can't do it.
Right. And also, I'll probably ask the person who does the town mowing to take that on.
Well, I do know the highway superintendent last year had his John Deere tractor with a brush hog on the back. I don't know if it was a town brush hog, but he had like a 6 or 8 foot brush hog.
That's what you know. I know they've got the roadside mower.
I understand it, but they had one on the back. Yes.
Huh. Okay.
I don't know if it's one that he borrowed from somebody or the town owns it now. I don't know, but he had it on the tractor.
Yeah. He might.
And that's what you'd mow it with.
He might have rented it.
Well, since we're talking about the Rose Field, there was something I wanted to bring up. I just last week read an article about pollinator gardens, that it's being suggested everybody, every place that can plant pollinator gardens because of the situation with pollinator bees.
You know, like we're doing at the grammar school.
They are?
Letting the milkweed grow. There.
Oh, yeah. Good.
They planted some.
Well, every time I see a milkweed out around where we are, I try to make sure it doesn't get cut down. But mm-hmm. while we are waiting for stuff, and I don't know if the town still has a garden club. They used to have a very active one.
Yes, we do.
If that might be something they'd be interested in looking into, that part of the rose field in the meantime, or even forever, if they build senior housing, it still wouldn't hurt to have a pollinator garden out there somewhere.
Absolutely.
And I've been told to go along with gardens, and this again is to do with the celebration next year. The Girl Scouts leaders in Conway are going to come in and ask us in the future, a very short future, the Girl Scouts would like to do a little flower project on the common by Jim's house for next year's celebration.
Oh, up by the...
Underneath them trees or just outside the trees.
Where the little cherry-looking trees are.
I think on the 116th side of the cherry trees.
Yeah.
Make a little arch there or something. Yeah. Just to beautify a little bit more for the...
And the garden club used to do that.
Yeah, and the Girl Scouts would like to do that as a project for the girls.
Well, that'd be nice.
Yeah, that would be.
Yeah,
great.
But they'll be coming to talk to us a little bit.
Okay. Okay, next item. Tom, are you all set with that?
Yep.
Okay. Next item on the agenda is to sign the employee recognition letter for Deborah Craven, custodian, firefighter, election worker. Do we have that letter?
Yes.
Okay.
Is it not in the...
Here it is. I didn't see it anywhere in the paperwork.
Sorry.
I have. Okay. Here we go. Thank you much.
You're very welcome.
Okay. This is a 15-year letter for Deb Craven, serving as in many capacities here in town as firefighter and custodian and election worker.
She's a great hard worker.
Yes, she is.
Really, I'm a wonderful person.
Yep, yeah, absolutely. I'll make a motion that we sign this letter.
Second.
Have a second. All in favor?
All right.
Okay, next item is to set a date for a meeting to review the Germain Fund scholarship applications. We all received a confidential packet with the applications tonight. Tom has suggested perhaps a meeting Friday during the daytime if we've had a chance to review these.
It's coming Friday.
And then to make decisions. Okay.
If people can make that.
What time?
Morning or afternoon better for people.
Morning's better for me, actually. You got better, John. You're the only working man here, son.
Yeah.
Okay. What's a good time for you guys in the morning?
Whatever's good for you.
You take.
How's 9 o'clock?
Wonderful.
Sounds
good.
9 o'clock.
Okay. 9 o'clock on Friday.
Town office, right?
Yeah.
Okay,
next item on the agenda is to appoint Sue McFarland to the Festival of the Hills Committee and the Scholarship Board until June 30th, 2016.
And considering that they want to become an independent group, at some point that will no longer fall to us.
Right, and that's one reason we felt comfortable doing it just to the end of this fiscal year.
Oh, right.
Which we would normally do anyway, and then reappoint everybody at the beginning of the next fiscal year.
Right. Okay, do I have a second to appoint Sue McFarland to the Festival of the Hills Committee?
She's good.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Okay, next item is to discuss the possible outcomes of the election and the ballot votes regarding the town clerk.
Yeah, I have an update on that.
Oh, good. What did our town council say?
We have a preliminary finding. We're still playing phone tag about the final finding.
Okay.
But in general, because the vote for a town clerk is on the same ballot as the vote to confirm moving it to an appointed position, the clerk... it's a contested election this year, so whoever the clerk that gets elected is will serve that full term as an elected official and it will become appointed at the end of that term. It would become effective.
Person that is elected?
It becomes effective at the end of the term of the person who holds the office. If it happens in the same year, the preliminary understanding is, based on the Mass General Law, and I do have to confirm this with him, that person does fill out that term of office. So it's a it's a three-year
term. What's your
term
limit now?
It's three years.
And she's got one year's up almost of it?
No, this is the three-year election.
This is the three-year.
So whoever gets elected will be elected for that three-year period, and then it will move to an appointed position.
So the election trumps the appointment, so to speak.
Yes.
Okay.
All right.
And again, that's a preliminary opinion. We still have to finalize it, but that's that's both of our understandings. That is the way it has worked in other towns.
Okay. So. All right. And do we have a... Who can verify that at the state? Well, this is Jack going to take care of that, calling the state on that.
Yeah, I think I think we can rely on Jack for that.
Okay, good. Okay, next item. Anything non-anticipated 48 hours in advance?
Yes.
Okay.
I have one thing. As Meg said, since this is a continuing item, because the tariffs are still in play and the Sandersfield thing is still in play and it's only suspended and this will continue, I would like to request that the select board appoint me to continue serving with MCAP until all of this gets resolved.
I'll make a motion that the select board continue your appointment with MCAP until such time as the pipeline situation is resolved one way or the other.
Now, were they just, before, I'm not in favor against this, but was that stipulated just selectmen on that committee, or what was that in the past?
I don't think so. It's just
I don't know how it's worded. I understand what you're saying.
That I was appointed to represent the select board on that committee.
Oh, okay.
But because I am, I have concerns and I've done a lot of work on it, I'd like to continue for whatever. I don't know how long. But yeah, I'll die probably before it's all resolved.
Okay, we have a motion on the floor. Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay, all in favor? Aye. Okay, you can't vote.
Right, I couldn't vote. Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
Okay. Tom, you have an update for us?
Other
than what you've already given us?
Yes, I do. I have a few things here. Just to note that the highway department did start its summer hours, which is Monday through Thursday, 10 hours, 6 to 4. We have been asked to allow a wedding reception on the ball field. I've cleared the scheduling with Parks and Rec, Cal Ripken, and women's softball, and our mower, and Snows, who's doing the fertilizing and degrubbing and all that kind of work. So everything seems clear, and there are strong ties that they have to Conway. They'll be married at a private home in Conway. But they are not residents, and we do have a field use policy, but I think it needs some updating, including having an application form and a hold harmless sign off. So I'm working on revising those.
Right.
I also look forward to Parks and Rec taking over the function of scheduling the field, which the original policy provides for. It actually provides for them to sign off on field use applications.
Now, do we know, are they going to be using electricity and stuff like that?
I presume they will be. And, you know, that's what the rental fee covers.
Right. Oh, there is a rental fee.
Oh, yes, there is a rental fee.
Okay. That was my question.
How about liability? We covered
that's what the hold harmless sign off is for, which we currently do not have.
Okay.
So I am
especially if they're going to be using alcohol.
Yeah, and they are required to have a police officer there if they're serving.
Okay.
They would have to have a 1-day liquor license from you if they were charging. for the owner.
They have to show us a liability policy that they have in place on a home somewhere or something to cover for that.
I've let them know. Usually the caterer will have that.
All right.
Yeah.
If this isn't a privacy thing, and they used to live in town, who is it? Do you know who it is?
I don't. We'll talk about
that. Okay, yeah. I'm just curious.
Have you discussed that with Jack at all?
No, I'm not at that stage. I want a revised policy to float
when do they want to do this?
In August, late August.
August. Okay, so this time. Yeah. Yeah, let's run this past Jack to make sure we covered all our bases.
The Attorney General's office was looking at our special town meeting bylaw for large construction. They requested an additional 60 days to review the bylaw, as it is the first of its kind.
A little complicated for them.
After speaking with them and corresponding with town council, together with considering that pipeline construction was unlikely to start within 60 days, and seeing that granting additional time was therefore not a policy decision, and they were coming up on their need for their deadline, I replied for the town that the additional 60 days was fine.
Sounds good.
Has any?
Are they asking us for a vote on town meeting floor this year on this?
No.
Okay.
No. They just want time to review it, and it was fine with Jack, and you know.
It doesn't involve a vote of our townspeople before it's approved by them.
No. I am planning to attend the annual Maya conference next week. This will give the town another percentage off its premium and get us to 5.5% out of a maximum of 6% per year. I believe that's the case. And I have one more thing, which is that it is the 5-year anniversary of another Town of Conway
public servant,
I think, is probably the best way to put it. And I have a letter of commendation for Chairman O'Rourke, signed by the other members of the Select Board, for his service for 5 years.
Isn't that great? Thank you very much, gentlemen.
Thank you.
I'm going to frame that.
Thank you for your service, by gosh.
Okay. God,
did you...
5 years already.
I happened to bring that letter I gave you from the police department over in Montague.
Was that in mail?
Maybe it's in mail. Okay.
Yeah, I think it's in mail.
Okay. I just wanted to make notes of it.
Okay. Nick, thank you, Tom. You have anything else? That's it, right?
That's it.
Okay. Concerns of the selectmen. We have any concerns tonight?
I got just one. Asked Tom, with your permission, to have the highway superintendent start looking at the condition of the street signs. Some of them are knocked down, some of them are missing, some are bent over from winter use, and I know the one that's knocked down is one down the common on Whitley Road. That's right. Laying on the grass.
I know. Is that state or is that us?
Well, it's state put them up, but I mean the Conway street signs. I've always maintained them.
Yeah, we got to get that one back up.
And just have them check them all around town because I'm sure the ones that they all need looking at, I think.
When was that accident? On Friday?
I don't think that was down before then.
Oh, was it?
Yes.
Really? No.
Well, those slippery roads a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah, I think that might have been
deadly.
Came down.
Oh, okay.
I'll check on
Definitely.
Who's responsible for that and make sure that he checks all the street signs to make sure they're in good
I have
condition.
One concern related to that, and that is, we've talked about signs before, and as I understood it, we've been told we can't just put up signs in town. The state has to do it, but then they don't want to maintain anything, but they want to control it.
That's true for speed signs.
Oh, just for speed
that's
signs?
That's not true for all signs, yes.
Oh, okay. All right. Good.
Now, you know about the new sign maker that FERCOG has, right?
No.
We can make signs. It's being kept at the Greenfield DPU, and if we have need for signs, we can go make signs.
Oh, wow. That's a good thing. Save us big money.
Yes, it is. So just make a note of that.
And there's new requirements, and I'm sure Ron can tell you this, there's new requirements in the last 2 or 3 years of what the sign size for street signs has to be. what size they have to be, what nature they have to be, their federal standard all across the nation. I'm trying to get everybody online together.
I know there's the reflectivity standards as well.
Well, I had volunteered, and that's still on board. It's a personal thing for me, because Pumpkin Hollow used to be the center of town, and there are a number of historic spots in Pumpkin Hollow. When I first moved to town, it was Pumpkin Hollow. Now it's Whaley Road, which I don't like. But to make signs for all those historical spots, and it will be, there's only one spot I think that is town property, and that's at the corner on the right where the old meeting house used to be, there by the cemetery. The others would be on private property if the people say, yes, it's okay to put one in front of my house. Historic places. So, anyway.
You have to make sure they're not in the town right away. That's all I'd say.
No, be on private. They'd be on private property.
Well, the right-of-way, just so that, you know, when snowplows go by.
Be at a point where people can see them.
Well, yes.
And
yes,
our tourists who come to town.
Yeah, just be aware that that's something to think
about. And I want to put one, and the other spot is the common, as you turn off into Pumpkin Hollow off 116.
Didn't the Historical Society talk about something like that?
Not that I know of.
Okay.
But there should be one there.
Sure. Thank you, Jim. Mm-hmm. All right, for mail. Okay, we have a letter from Matt Boyden. Matt is going to be resigning as Emergency Management Director as of June 30th. He's got some other responsibilities at work, and that's taking up a lot of his time. He has offered to help in the transition to a new emergency management director, and he'll help with that when we come up with one. So,
yeah, I just spoke to him yesterday.
That's right. I had a discussion today with Dave Chichester, who's the assistant emergency management director.
Right.
And he has told me, I asked him if he would allow me to recommend him to take the position for 1 year. He only wants to do him 1 year increments. He said he would be interested in taking the position.
Oh, good.
And he's done it before.
Yeah.
He's gone to all the meetings. He knows the whole show.
Right. I know at the ham and bean dinner the other night, I spoke with Matt, and Matt said maybe Dave would be interested.
Dave said he would take it. He has thought about it. He said he would take it. So.
Yeah, good.
Okay. Well, that's good. That's outstanding.
So I don't know. Do we have to ask for applications from other people in town first?
Yeah, well, we get some sort of official word from Dave on that.
I'll work with him on that.
We'll appoint him. Okay. Next item is a letter from the Department of Environmental Protection.
It's regarding the oil spill in the middle of town, just a couple doors down from the town hall. There have been a lot of trucks out there pumping contaminated soil out of the basement of a house where oil was pumped into inadvertently. And this is a status update and letting the project people know what's required in terms of monitoring abutters' wells and things like that.
Okay.
What's being done in order to keep it from spreading.
Okay. Those right through there, those used to be shallow wells for all those houses. You may remember that.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Tom, for that explanation. We have a letter from Frontier Regional from Principal Darius Motso, and he's inviting us to commencement at Frontier on June 1st at 7 o'clock in the auditorium, and graduation, that's class night.
June 1st, you said?
June 1st at 7 p.m. and graduation June 3rd at 7 p.m. on the football field, weather permitting.
What time is that graduation?
At 7.
7 to.
We have a letter from Kimberly Bowes at FERC. Just letting us know that as a result of inadequate capacity commitments from the prospective customers and a determination that the project is uneconomic. Kinder Morgan, Tennessee parent company, announced on June 20th that the company would suspend further work and expenditures on the project. Okay, at this time, Tennessee is in the process of determining how best to proceed consistent with existing contracts. As a result, Tennessee respectfully requests that the commission not take any further action in processing the application pending Tennessee submitting a status report to the commission no later than May 26. Okay, so they've suspended work. They're going to look at their contracts. They're going to resubmit a status report on the 26th of May. So we'll know at the end of May what's happening a little better than we know now.
Unless they delay it.
Well,
which is again, a possibility. But like, we'll know something on the 26th.
As Tom said, that's probably a soft deadline.
Yeah. Probably, yes.
Okay, we have a save the date from the Division of Local Services. This is for New Officials Finance Forum, Wednesday, June 1st at Holy Cross College.
I figure that would be good for the new select board member.
Absolutely. This, I went to this, and I've gone to other forums that they've held at Holy Cross, and they're all very good. Division of Local Services does a great job. And a lot of good information they give you, and it's extremely educational, extremely critical to know this stuff.
Yeah, I went to some of those at first, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think none of the ones I attended were there at Holy Cross, but...
That's usually where the Division of Local Services has theirs.
Yeah, maybe it wasn't the Division of Local Services that I attended.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But it was for new select board members and such.
Right, yeah. We also have the annual report from Franklin Regional Council of Governments, which has an awful lot of information and gives us an idea of all the services they provide to Conway. Mm-hmm. And the last two pages have all those services, so it's a very interesting report.
Did we just get one copy of that, did we?
This is the board's copy.
Select board copy. Yeah. There are other copies. And I do not see in there the letter that...
The letter you were talking about, I don't see it. I thought it was in here. The fire chief's letter?
No.
Which
letter? The letter from the police department in Montague, isn't
it? The Montague Police Department.
Commendation for Officer Paramba from them for work above and beyond.
It's not in this folder, is it?
It shouldn't be.
No.
Well, I apologize for that, and I will have it next time.
Be it
known that Officer Parambo was commended for extraordinary work from the town of Montague. And we will have more to say about that next time, then.
Okay. He assisted in bringing a person back to life.
Oh.
Wow.
Well, that's good.
Yeah. Yeah.
We'll bring it. Yeah, we'll bring it up next time.
Okay. Any other announcements? Okay. No other announcements. Next meeting is scheduled for Monday, May 9th. 6:30 p.m. Grammar School, right here again, before the town meeting. Any other business to come before the board? I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ben. Thank you, Liz.